Good morning, our viewers on Urban TV. Thank you for watching Urban Today with my colleagues Lynn Kongisha and Henry Saka. My name is Julius Kafuruma. I'm here in Chisoro district, here in Chigezi sub-region in the western part of the country. Now, Chigezi sub-region is one of the areas that have been hit badly by the lockdown, since it hosts one of the biggest tourist attractions in the country. That is the mountain gorillas, and these mountain gorillas are found here in Chisoro district, in Mugahinga Mountain and Bwindi Impenetrable National Park. However, with over $1.6 billion that the country has been getting from tourism, and almost contributing 10.4% to the national GDP, tourism has really been doing very well here in Chisoro district. However, it has been badly hit by the lockdown pandemic, coronavirus pandemic, and now we are on our recovery in terms of tourism. However, I've been joined by the district tourism officer, that is Richard Monezero, to discuss with us how they have been badly hit and what they are planning to ensure that they can reboost tourism in Chisoro district. Good morning, Richard. You're live on Urban TV.
Good morning, Julius. Thank you so much for hosting me, and we are glad that you are spreading this information that will help Ugandans also appreciate and come to Chisoro.
All right. Yep. If you were to tell Ugandans out there who don't know Chisoro very well, what are some of the tourist potentials, attractions that are found here in Chisoro?
Actually, when you talk of tourism, you mean Chisoro. That in summary, everyone who wants to enjoy tourism, everyone who wants to know about tourism must come to Chisoro, because Chisoro is the one key tourism destination in Uganda that has almost that is supposed to be seen by tourists in Chisoro. Yeah. But just to begin with, one of the key tourism products in Uganda is Gorilla Tourism, which is a unique selling point, a unique selling product. Tourism product in Chisoro, those are mountain gorillas. 70% of tourists who come to Uganda at least want to see the mountain gorillas. And mountain gorillas are only hosted by Chisoro, in Mugahinga and Bwindi. So it's one of our key primary attractions that complements these other many and million attractions that I can't talk now.
All right.
We have cultural sites, historical sites, lakes and so forth. Yeah.
There are so many. But how have the people of Chisoro been affected by the lockdown?
Actually, sometimes when I even want to talk about this, I almost shed tears, because Chisoro is one of the districts that has been really earning from tourists, and both from local investors and other investors outside Chisoro. We have been having people who have been running hotels. And when I mention hotels, I don't mean these town hotels, the Kampala hotels, by the way. Mm-hmm. I mean high-end lodges. Chisoro has high-end lodges. Mm-hmm. You find, actually, the majority we have are charging from 800 to 1,000 USD. Mm-hmm. But all these lodges have closed down because we have been targeting foreign tourists. So they have closed down. Mm-hmm. And when they close down now, you can see the whole value chain being affected. Meaning the tour operators are not working, they are not transporting, the tour guides are not working, the porters who carry the bags of tourists are not working, the people who supply vegetables in these hotels are not working, the foreign exchange, the banks, everything. So you find the whole value chain is closed because of just one. Yeah.
Okay.
In general, Chisoro, we have been targeting the foreigners, and indeed it has been our successful story. Yeah.
Now, since now you no longer have that,
yep.
What do you think needs to be done by especially UWA or government or Minister of Tourism to ensure
yes.
that at least you can balance between foreign foreign tourists and local tourism?
Yeah, actually, of course, charity begins at home. Let me begin by Chisoro District. We have put in place some measures. One, we have reviewed our district tourism plan. We have mapped all these potential tourism products that we can sell to domestic. I want actually, as Ugandans, we start now looking at our level before we go to foreigners. That's the mistake I think as a country we've been making. Only we have been targeting the foreigners, but we have learned that local products can be developed and can suit the locals. So as a Kisoro, we have now developed a district 5-year development plan that has developed all these potential products. That's step number one. Number two, we are happy, of course, our collaboration with Uganda Wildlife Authority. The prices have been reduced, for instance, this Christmas. Ugandans have been doing gorilla tracking for 250,000. Now it is only 1,500. The same to foreigners, from 700 to 400, as you can see. So this is going to attract. But also, when I get back to local level, now as a district, we are looking for the ways of how we can further grow the industry. We have trained the guides now. I hope for the coming season now, everyone will be really doing it in the best way it can be done. So we have trained them. But also on top of that, I appeal and I still request the government at the central level, the UNRWA, to come now and work on the roads, because it's one of our major effects. The district is trying its best to maintain these tourism roads, but you know it doesn't cover the entire district, because many roads are for UNRWA and the district just does the small portion of it.
All right.
Yeah.
That's Richard Munezero, the district tourism officer of Chisoro district, telling you how they've been badly hit by the lockdown and what they feel needs to be done to ensure that they can recapitalize on that to boost tourism potentials here in Chisoro district. I will be taking you back to studios with my colleagues Lynn Komgisha and Henry Sekanjako. They will be taking you through more of that. But right now, me, Julius Kafuma, and Deo Chalgonza, we are saying bye to you. Continue enjoying Urban Today.
Yes, thank you very much, Julius Kafuma. Kafuma is in Chisoro. He was, and actually is, still following up on where the president, who is also the NRM presidential candidate, is supposed to be, what people want him to address. That was Chisoro district. But the thing is, he never showed up yesterday. The president never went to Chisoro. And according to reports, he took some, you know, time to rest. But Chisoro leaders were not very happy because they expected him, they were looking forward to the day, and I think somehow they had issues. I remember that. I was reading news somewhere that they were actually blaming Bahati. To say that he was too selfish and... anyway, so it's politics there. Okay, gentlemen and ladies, joining me this morning is Vivian Kamsime, is Darren Bartlett, and also the one and only Tony Geoffrey Owana. Good morning, gentlemen and the lady.
Good morning, man.
Be blessed.
Morning.
I have never understood why he does that.
Aruga.
But it is okay.
Egirimit.
Obviously.
Mm-hmm.
So, people, what stood out for you this week? I want to start with you, Vivian. What stood out for you this week?
Of course, the COVID-19 pandemic is only getting worse. We see a number of people who are dying. We see prominent people dying. I know some people keep saying maybe they have other issues, other medical issues.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, without COVID, maybe they could have stayed longer. And COVID is only making it worse. We know that ICU is very expensive. Generally, even without COVID, ICU is a very expensive place.
Yes.
To administer medication.
Mm.
I've been to ICU myself before.
Mm.
And yes, when I gave birth to my first child, I had preeclampsia.
Ah, okay.
And that took me to ICU. It was not a good thing, so I can only imagine what is going on in ICU.
Mm.
First of all, the medication is very aggressive. It is all the time. The workers are worn out. Of course, we know we have very few ICUs in the country already, the ventilators. So the COVID pandemic is actually making it worse.
Absolutely.
And it is not a good place for us to be as a country. The World Health Organization is warning us individually. You shouldn't be thinking that the pandemic or the coronavirus is affecting people in the UK, in the US, or people who are not on your village, or exactly within your vicinity.
Mm.
It is actually a personal issue right now.
That's true.
You should be thinking about who are you going to meet, where are you going, must you really make that visit to someone, should you actually be going to town to roam around, to do shopping. Those are issues that you're supposed to be thinking about as a matter of
day. Call it gallivanting, because some of you just want to gallivant
around town.
Yes. Darren, yes. What stood out for you this week, and what was trending in the socials?
Yeah. quite a lot, mm-hmm. but in the relevant fields, mm-hmm. I want to call them relevant because yes. we, you know, the rest are always things that people just throw up and hear and trolling people. So one of them is, she said, COVID.
Mm-hmm.
We had the highest number recorded in Uganda.
In 1 week?
In a day.
In a day, by the way, yeah. 1,000,
yeah.
over
1,198 is not a simple number. And those are the ones who either go, who have reported symptoms, those one who don't fear to go and report. But there's so many there who are treating themselves.
That's
so
true.
It tells you there's something wrong in the community.
Mm.
Two, the ballot papers. The first bunch of ballot papers arrived.
Yes.
In the country. And people were now saying, now I think it is, we are going into the right direction.
Mm-hmm.
Three, the appointment of the Deputy Uganda Investment Authority.
Director.
Is now Deputy Director. Because
yes.
they said the position was not
was
existing.
Was not,
it
has been
created. a gentleman who was also campaigning against, or who was standing against our Minister of Finance, Matia Kasaija, sorry.
Yes,
sorry.
Yes.
So that appointment letter has been moving on social media and has been a huge conversation.
That's right.
I am sure I hosted someone here for entertainment, but they should have told you that Uganda is hosting Mama Awards.
Oh, yes.
Yeah. And,
oh, yes.
And Uganda had its own category, Uganda's Best Act, just as Uganda.
Just as Uganda.
With quite a number of artists. So that too was trending. Mm. And it is up to now, it is still actually making rounds because there's now a debate, how can Bebe Cool be here? How can that one be here? And me, I concluded, and I'm sorry, Owana. But
why?
Does Owana know these things?
Today's music is, but no one knows our old music.
Oh, okay.
Including you, our. Okay.
So that's what was.
Okay, okay.
I'm sure Henry Chamber is laughing.
Oh, and what trended for you? I know he hates when I don't ask him what was trending. So what was trending for you this week?
I was trending.
What did you do?
Or
what did you not do?
You were joking. What trended for these people trended for me also?
There's something, there's somewhere they mentioned you somewhere.
Did they?
I don't know what you did.
You must remember it.
I will remember.
Now, the other, apart from these trended for me. These.
We?
Yes.
Okay.
But I also saw a picture of two ministers
uh-huh.
Who had gone for treatment abroad.
Allegedly.
Yes, but the picture is of 2016.
Can you imagine?
That's what we are doing these days to make news. Mm. The paper came out in 2016.
Imagine.
2017, around there.
Uh-huh.
Now, for me, a friend of mine is in came out of ICU in Mbarara Hospital. Kano Ulysses Chuka Chibuka Mukasa Kanywa Mugule. He sent me a message saying they tested me for COVID and I don't have, but there is a dangerous lung infection that is going around, which seems to have been overshadowed by COVID.
It is pneumonia-like.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Because with Chibuka, they tested him, no COVID, but he was dying. Uh-huh. So he said, if you want to die quickly, he even mentioned that our age group, you remove the mask. Now, that is an old warrior. He doesn't fear many things, but he told me, you people, be careful.
Hey!
Now, the other one is, of course, Miam an archive. 40 years ago today, we were waiting for Semogere to be announced the winner.
Of an election?
As young members of the Democratic Party. Mami, gumire, gumire, DP. They didn't announce. Instead, the army came and told us to go away. We had gathered at London House. Hmm? You know where
Wait,
it is?
Where is London House?
Johnstone Street. You know London House?
Johnstone Street.
Yeah. You know where there was that mall?
Which mall?
It is actually behind to where, I don't want to mention the name of a bank because I would be making a lot of color, mm-hmm. but it is behind that, it's Bank of Africa basically behind.
No.
Yeah.
When you come from CPS and you are going to Arua Park, come down from CPS, drive to Arua Park.
Yeah, uh-huh.
That first building there is Johnstone Street. That's where DP headquarters was.
It's still there, I think.
No, it is at City House. No, it is even in Kawempe now.
Anyway, guys.
So we were celebrating.
Just confusing me.
We were celebrating.
You're thinking about some other house.
No, where I'm telling him the place is. It's where he's actually. It's also
no, no, no. There's no bank there.
Anyway. But there was Bank of Africa there.
Okay.
Okay.
So a senior army officer came and told us, if in 20 minutes you are still here, you will see.
What?
Later in the day, the person who was ruling Uganda made an announcement. He said, I have taken over the powers of the Electoral Commission. Anyone found announcing the results of any nature will be jailed for 5 years or pay a fine of $500,000 or both. That was Paulo Mwanga.
Ayabas.
Then we retired.
Hey, I tell you, what can you do?
That was only 40 years ago.
Now, gentlemen, we have seen that the country has registered 3,600 cases in just 1 week of COVID-19, before we can get political about this. And hospitals are quite overwhelmed. Few supplies, they're running out of oxygen. We have very many people, sick and admitted. We have seen that Chirunda Chivejinja is in ICU. We have MP Kasivante, we have MP Tulia Mweza. We have very many people who have passed on this week from COVID. It has become a huge problem. My question is, what did we do wrong? And why are we at this point in this particular, this time? How come we never planned ahead for this? I will start with you, Wana.
Didn't we?
Did we?
When we got into a lockdown, the government was not locking out COVID.
Yes.
It was locking us in to get prepared for our getting sick. And they did. They did. Almost every hospital that didn't have ICU got ICU.
That's right.
Some facilities were converted into hospitals, including stadiums.
Yes.
Now, that is what you call some measure of readiness. But there are two things, as you are saying, what didn't we do? One, I mentioned here earlier, that the information ministry of this country did not prepare the public for COVID. What do I mean? We left a general impression that it was a joke.
Yes.
So when politics also came in, it became a contest for whether this is not just Museveni's trick to keep us away. And then when it came to enforcing SOPs, police became selective. Now people started to express their freedom. Some of these, this spike, you call it a spike? It is coming from our rallies.
And people are in denial, it's not.
Okay, let them deny, but the point is, it is coming from rallying. You will rally at politics and you move all over the country. Then you can rally in markets. The difference with the markets is that no one stays there for very long, except the sellers.
Yes.
But they rally. So now, because the message of danger did not sink in, we began experimenting. And many of us have suffered. There cannot be a readiness that prevents disease. And me, I think that we have been doing well. Because when you compare, in US they were recently celebrating Thanksgiving Day. The government of US said, people don't travel.
Yes.
But 12 million Americans traveled to celebrate Thanksgiving
and
Day.
They are regretting.
Now they are crying.
Yes.
So you might think America is very much advanced in terms of awareness. They are worse than us.
That's right.
Maybe it's because for us we can't travel very much, but we are also doing our bit. So in short, there can be no real readiness than you have now. And now government finally said, it is now up to you. We have reached the up to you stage, and that is
dangerous.
Absolutely.
Darren, Some political commentators are actually saying that COVID-19 has been politicized, and everything is tagged. COVID is used as a weapon against the opposition. Actually, this was Nancy Kalembe saying. She says that it is using it as a weapon to control anyone in the opposition. Others are saying that we had time to suspend the elections to avoid what we are what we are currently, you know, facing as a country. We have been put on a red flag right now. Do you think it has actually been politicized, and this is why we are losing the fight?
First, give me some information. Is Nancy Kalembe in opposition, or she's a candidate?
She's a candidate, but she's
also opposition.
But she's opposition anyway.
You can't separate her, because as long as you oppose the current government.
Yeah.
I thought she was opposing the electoral commission.
She's contesting against the current government.
Oh, okay.
Yes.
I want to say that, and I will say what I said the other time, that you see, politicians are liars, and they have those bad manners of lying to the public. They want to use. They tend to play with the circumstances available, situation at hand,
mm-hmm.
and say and become victims. They mm-hmm. make themselves victims. But thank God, Elias Lukwago is now fine. He came back into the country.
Oh, Amina. Mm.
Maybe he should be talking to them and telling them. I don't know whether he had COVID. No, I know he
but
had.
We don't know.
I know he had a respiratory issue.
It could have been the infection he was talking about.
And he in his addresses, he said, look, guys, you need to wear your masks. You need them. Okay? So politicians are preaching the wrong gospel.
Mm.
I even don't know why we even went ahead to have political activities in this season.
That's right.
If you're following Singapore today, they extended their elections. They actually said they are not going to happen. The transition is not going to happen because they're still facing a pandemic. But guess how many cases they reported there? Three. Now, if someone is reporting three cases and they have such measures, mm. they know it's a tourism, you know, it attracts so many people around the world. Singapore attracts so many people around the world to go there, but they have restricted travel.
Yes.
Not coming into the country, not traveling beyond, I think, 20 kilometers. That's how hard it is for them mm. to move around. But here, we have not realized how dangerous COVID is until someone loses a family member to COVID. Now we don't, because we've not lost people who are close to us. I have lost a friend.
I think on Tuesday
she passed on, and it was all over social media.
Yes.
So if you don't lose your loved one, it does not sink in. It has not.
Are we going to wait for that time for every family to
that is what that is what
for the lesson to sink in?
Yes. Exactly. Should mm. we?
That is what they want. And I also made a comment yesterday on the screaming headline. I think it was also in our paper about government debating or preparing to open schools on full blast.
Yes, yes. It's even today.
Are we mad?
Donors are actually asking government to
reopen
schools.
Yesterday we reported, and because it was the other day when we reported 1,198
cases.
And then the following day you're seeing a paper saying we want to open schools full blast. Mm. What are we in a rush for?
Democracy.
But where is the problem?
The problem is, you know, by the way, let me tell you. Even the Minister of Health and Information, they moved on. And I'm sorry to say this. The thing is, the information they used to give us then when the virus had just landed, they stopped. You watch today these Kenyan TVs and see, it's either the President or the Minister of Health addressing the nation every day. Try, you watch, even today.
We are in a political season, I guess. That's why we
the
moved.
President will be campaigning.
Well, the office did not stop. I expect, I know she's, Diana Trinh is doing her best. I've heard her on some radio speaking.
Yeah.
But the aggressiveness of the message
has gone.
It has been diluted. It is lost. Our own corporate companies here who channeled all their adverts into COVID.
They have moved.
And I've changed back to Davoro. We
moved on. Daron, someone warned from the National Association of Broadcasters that, are you sure the president wants to campaign? That's where we are.
Vivian, as we wind up on this COVID discussion, there are talks that we could have avoided this whole political campaigns and elections on at the onset, because we had time, allegedly, because when we had that COVID spreads like this, we could have said, but we have elections coming, we should have thought ahead. Do you think that would have been a better option for us?
I must say, I don't think that would have been a better option for us either, because as we already see it, some candidates or people actually thought it must happen. The
yes.
election must happen.
Mm-hmm.
We know that some civil society organizations came out to say, if you have these elections, people are going to get excited. We know that politics is very divisive by nature. So they actually wanted to avoid this whole kind of feeling that is going on. But in Ethiopia, where the prime minister actually decided to push the election from this year, they have been having problems because some other region decided to actually organize elections.
On its own?
Yes, on their own. So we could have seen some of those things coming through. At the beginning, the president hinted on it, and some people were not happy.
Oh, yeah.
He's coming up with his usual tricks again.
Yes.
And you know what is also very interesting or contradictory right now is that even when the police keeps arresting people over crowds and not following SOPs, we're like government ploy to curb opposition from winning or, you know, spreading their message.
That's
so
true.
It is a very complicated dynamics, but as it is right now, we are already in it. Yes, the campaign period was shortened a bit when the election was brought forward, the election date.
You might as well call it the infection period.
I think so.
I want to emphasize a point.
Which one?
Of opposition. And when I call them liars and users, sorry, not politicians.
I'm watching.
At large. You see, people are going to die of this virus, and they are going to use that very card. Because right now they are saying, no, you're using this card against us that you can't mobilize. But what is going to happen is when people start dying and falling sick, they will say, you see, your government doesn't have hospitals. See, your government did not prepare. See, your government did not.
You said that our government is not prepared, or the messages are not coming through.
Mm.
I think that's a bit unfair, because time and again, we have seen these ministers or different government officials come out and tell people, guys, this is getting out of hand. You're now on your own. Take the SOPs very seriously.
Absolutely. Now,
and like people choose to listen to the politics.
And when you say you're on your own, guess what? Treatment, COVID-19 treatment daily in the ICU is about 2 million shillings.
You added the word only.
But you see.
No, it's not only.
This is minus supplies, this is minus drugs to you know, use.
Drugs.
What? This is crazy. What? Lynn, what is happening? I'm wondering
tell you the truth, like I said, ICU medication is very expensive.
Mm-hmm.
And because you're in ICU, there will be developing situations. So even the 2 million is like the least, the underestimate, the small estimate that you're talking about.
It is the least.
You said I was thinking of politics. I want everybody to read the works of Reverend Thomas Malthus.
Uh-huh. What does he say?
Diminishing returns.
Okay.
He said population will be controlled by war, pestilence, and famine.
Yes.
Yes.
Mm.
So all the people, we people who are gathering here,
mm-hmm.
that's what this boy Bebe Cool was saying. He said, keep your thing so that you vote for your candidate. Don't gather.
Yes.
Because rallies are not polling centers.
Mm-hmm.
So are you going to invest your life in rallying and fail to vote?
But
there you are.
Let me ask you, do we have capacity to handle what is coming? Because I think this is just the beginning of a huge explosion.
But Lynn, I've always warned you that the best hospitals on earth also have mortuaries, meaning they get ready. So what do you mean by are we ready?
As a country.
The elements of the military who are in this COVID operation are studying what you are asking. How many deaths can we anticipate in this period? These people have remarkable figures,
mm-hmm.
and they are waiting to. Yeah. How many coffins should be this? How many? They have that. Mm-hmm. So is that the readiness you are talking about?
I mean, we need more than that.
What you should prepare your people for is to bury their loved ones, because it's going to happen. When you talk of readiness,
I was trying not to say that.
No, you better say it. You are a great broadcaster. Say it gently, unlike me. But let the message go through that we are going into a bad, we are already in a bad situation.
We are in stage four.
So let us not be taken by surprise. Every person who invests in trouble should suffer. Unfortunately, we don't suffer alone when we invest in the trouble.
Experts have warned, don't travel for Christmas.
Yeah, but again, Ugandans being Ugandans. You see?
I hate that.
You see, I was listening to radio the other time on some political show, and one politician standing somewhere to be an MP said, life in Kampala is different from the one outside Kampala. Yeah, everything is normal. That's what he said.
Yes, everything I agree. I've heard that too.
Everything is normal.
I've
life
had
is
that
going
too.
Good as usual.
I've had that too.
Now if what I say is prepare to bury, that's what he means. So they are living a normal life, but that's what is going to happen.
Now, for me, why I also oppose going for Christmas is every Christmas season, for instance, the transporters, they hike fares.
Yes.
As if the distance to Maya Mungura
has increased.
So what I advise people to do, don't go.
It is the law.
Get the Kamane, send it to your people, and don't go. Because what are you going to do? To spend the money from there?
And it's a spread COVID.
Transport accounts for provisions for a week. Send them the money and don't go.
Okay, gentlemen and lady, we need to move away from COVID-19, but trust me, we are in a very, very bad phase, and you need to be very, very careful. Now, talking of being very careful, campaigns are still going on as we head into the festive season. Campaigns are still going on. We are seeing that, of course, Chagulanyi is still clashing with police. At the start of the week, I thought things had eased a bit, but then tear gas came up again, and somehow we're celebrating that all that chaos.
Tear gas.
So, gentlemen, what I want us to look at is that somebody has written an interesting thing and said there's a symbiotic relationship between ordinary Ugandans and politicians. We don't really listen to what they say and what we don't really listen to what the politicians are saying, and they also just pretend to listen to what we say. Owen, I'll start with you.
No, I don't agree with that one.
Why?
Although I also know that politicians know what to say, when, and to who.
Mm-hmm.
And the audience also wants to hear certain things. At the risk of being criticized by one of my superiors here, because me, I'm biased. I am biased.
Yeah, we know.
Yeah, I am biased. When you start interrogating promises of candidates, you can't do it at a rally. You can't.
Okay.
You can only do it at a private meeting and say, but really, you, how do you? But this one, yeah, Museveni, then he moves to the next stage.
Mm.
So what has he said?
Mm-hmm.
Either the old things or some mysterious.
What you want to hear.
Uh-huh. So that's how you end up having wild promises and we clap.
Mm-hmm.
Mm? Meaning that that is the symbiotic relationship you are talking about, that let's deceive each other until after the elections. But that's not the reality.
The ballot will decide.
No. Let me tell you, these Ugandans you see here are not very foolish. Hmm? They may get excited. Yesterday I was watching some clip in a place, was it Elegu?
Elegu,
towards Elegu.
Yes.
You know, everybody who was chanting when they were going to Elegu was speaking my mother's tongue, Luganda.
Hey, how did they get there?
They learned the language.
Okay.
I don't want to assume that they were exported there. They oh man, our favorite. They said, these Westerners are really. So we have agreed to deceive each other.
Mm.
But you see, the day of reckoning comes when people begin asking, what did you say the other time? So we must get out of it. Let's not embrace it as if it is the way to go. Like you are saying, we Ugandans.
Mm.
We must get out of that, we Ugandans.
Mm.
Mm? We Ugandans is hurting us tremendously.
I know.
Now I have heard, and I stand to be corrected, the other time I was nearly reprimanded. There is an effort to make sure that the presidential debate does not take place.
An effort by who?
By the organizers.
Yeah, the organizers did mention that, from what we heard,
due to financial constraints
and, of course, COVID-19. So they're like, we can't.
There is more danger in rallies
for COVID-19
than in a presidential debate with people in a huge hall with the cameras.
But what are they going to debate that we don't know yet?
We have never asked the candidates any questions.
Ah.
They have always been singing and chanting and promising the old things like President Museveni.
Uh-huh.
When are we going to get chance to ask them questions when they are not talking about their opponents?
Right.
Uh-huh. That can only be done at a presidential debate, which the organizers are saying they are too broke to do what?
To hold.
I can assure you, donors out there can refuse us money for COVID and give us money for organizing such a thing. There is something fishy.
We shall find it out.
Will you?
We will try. Darren, people are saying that Chagulanyi, the whole security, I was seeing very heavy artillery around him, very heavy, what are they called? Okay. cars, those heavy security cars around him, and I think this is giving him some leverage over the, of course, his opponents. But then President Museveni says that his Chagulanyi is just reactionary and not radical.
See, why do other people have to complain? Why the other people? Okay, that was interesting.
Now you are done.
The reason why the other candidates will feel like it's unfair for them is because they're not in the media. And you know, today's media reports where problems are.
Yep.
The good things will come another time. It's just like when you work on TV, even here, or even on radio, you will say all the good things and no one will.
We'll pay attention.
No one may even, but you make
Mbogo
here.
Ah, yeah.
This clip will go viral.
You see the candidate who says, let us ask God to be the guide. That's a very good message. Does it serve?
He's not
now, it's not serving him.
How many times have you had Fred Mayambala? Where is it? All
you don't even know.
I know them, but this is the thing. They are not as popular as the other two,
the first two,
probably three somewhere.
Okay.
Always in the media.
Mm-hmm.
Why? Because they are not chaotic. They are probably not even having their campaigns.
Mm-hmm.
Or they are just silent. We don't know what is happening to them. Whereas the other time, everyone is anticipating. Today, what has happened to Bobby? Because every day he has tear gas. So every day there will always be something about.
Maybe it's because they are defiant.
No. Okay, that could be there, but because of the message they are putting out, we shall rally people, we shall do this. So everyone wants to see, what is this defiance? How is this defiance going to go? How is it going to end?
Mm-hmm.
On the other hand, Museveni is always, you know, put in contrast there to see what he's doing, what is the other person doing.
Mm-hmm.
The others, I don't know, I think we shall have another case in court come 2021 where the media is going to be sued for being unfair. But in the actual sense, the media is looking
reporting.
For news. Which one says the bad news that our journalists don't cover, they need the actual news. It is okay. But the thing is, people are going out for what is going to make stories for their media houses, and then they'll end up covering three candidates.
Mm.
Three. Because of what has happened in their camps.
That's right.
Now,
even master organizer Tumukunde was crying.
And I can tell you this. Do you know that this campaign may end when Bobi Wine has not spent a coin buying media on TV?
It is possible.
Why? Because you're giving him free media.
Well, over to you, Vivian. There's people, a certain section of the public is saying that disinvest in politics and bullets and tear gas, but put your focus in human capital and health. What are your thoughts on that?
Of course, we know that human capital and health are issues that are going to stay. long after the, right now, the chaos, the elections are gone. The tear gas comes in when the riots come, the, you know, the divergent views, if you like.
Mm-hmm.
You might want to say the divergent views bring clashes.
Of course.
Then people want to riot, people want to express their views more aggressively, and so on and so forth. The human capital is the hardcore, if I must say, of our country, of the different systems of society. So it is very important or paramount that the government actually takes care of these. Because even on other days when we do not have COVID-19, there are a number of issues that must be dealt with so that the country moves forward long after COVID-19, like I said, elections and all these things.
Mm-hmm.
Therefore, investing in tear gas and all the, they call it security, time and again has been looking like a ploy to deal with opposition and a number of things that maybe the government does not like to keep in power. And I think this is unfair. It is only right that we invest in the health of people, because at the end of the day, you want a population to lead. You want.
You also want people to vote.
Yes, you also want people to vote. You want people to come up. They are the leaders of tomorrow.
Mm.
Yes.
Okay. I'm coming back to Owana. Owana has covered the different elections and all these things. Most importantly,
even
the manifestos. Even were there transitions?
They have always been there.
The transition.
Okay.
Whatever they looked like.
Oh, and here it is. Mm-hmm. The president has been in the Western region, specifically his home area, Ntungamo.
Mm.
And people there did ask him a couple of things. They called on him to say, we need roads, we need clean water and health services, they need financial support to train farmers.
Excuse me, is that Karamoja?
No, that's Mbara.
Who is so below, something strange.
So the question here is, he has been in power for the last 35 years, okay? But his home area is still grappling with two things that caught my attention. They don't have clean water. And health services are not what we should expect them to be. What is wrong? Really, people are worried. They're saying, really, 35 years in your home area? We have Muntu coming from Ntungamo. We have Babi Chagwanyi from Ntungamo. We have the First Lady from Ntungamo. All that is put in one. What do you think of this?
I have been to Ntungamo before, and I didn't drink dirty water.
Okay.
Uh-huh.
Maybe
hotel. I went to the wrong Ntungamo.
He went to a hotel, definitely.
In Ntungamo?
Yes.
I remember when Dr. Besigye was showing us bad roads in Rukunjiri. He went somewhere towards a garden, but he had driven from Kasangati to Rukunjiri on tarmac. So he looked for where there was still a problem. And it was some path leading to some garden, which he wanted it tarmacked. So there will always be needs everywhere. But I can tell you, if Ntungamo was having all those facilities and not Wachiso,
yes,
the story would again change.
That's
and
true.
Then he said, you see? Everything is going to Ntungamo. I think those are marks for this old man. If he has not been just sending things to Ntungamo because he's born there, then maybe. But I have pictures of these places 35 years ago and today. Me, I only compare my pictures. I don't do other things. Uh-huh. So when people express what they need, that's good. But for them to say that for 35 years they have been waiting for clean water, they should have died long ago after drinking all that dirty water for 35 years. You should have died long ago. Mm. So, what am I reading? Because Museveni has refused to hold these huge rallies, he has to rely for information from ordinary people, from Chagulanyi's rallies. Because even Chagulanyi, they tell him things which they need. Related to Inamazi, you know, And I think Museveni is using Chagulanyi as a sounding board.
Okay.
To hear what ordinary people are saying. But finally, for me, I have a yardstick. When you say there's no medicine, I want you to mention the hospital and what you were suffering from. This young woman has told us she was in ICU. That's a personal experience.
Mm-hmm.
Conversely, the great Segirinya Muhammad one time called into top radio and said, Ndiwano mwai see you, Ndibubinyo. The only person on earth who was ever called
in an ICU.
From an ICU was Segirinya. The other one was Zake. Zake was removed from ICU in Rubaga
and taken
to Nsambia for a scan. Then they brought him back to the ICU. Then they took him to India in an ICU, and the story said, "Bamujeko balabo banafa." So really, you people.
We need to wind up, but there's something that happened this week. Chagulanyi endorsed Ayume, Dr. Ayume, in Koboko.
My English is not good, but endorsed is not the correct word.
Okay. I stand to be corrected.
Yeah.
He actually campaigned. He said he's the right person.
He did.
Yes, he campaigned for him, for Koboko.
Mm.
I want to know from you people, does this change the face of politics in any way? And what does it mean for us as a as people who are going to vote anyway? Darren, I'll start with you.
Koboko has always been an NRM
stronghold.
Yes.
So I would want to say that maybe he's bouncing off that. Say, you see, when I go to Koboko, let me support this young man. So people see that I am with them for me to get
he
that.
He didn't
kind
have
of
a candidate for National Unity Platform.
When it's there, opposition people were standing against, there is an independent candidate. Why not the independent candidate?
Mm-hmm.
You get the point?
Mm-hmm.
Eh? So you might want to go and support the other person so that you leverage off them to win your own support.
Right.
Yeah, but the politics of Koboko this year has become something else. Clips have been moving around of a minister.
Being the gate.
Supply, being the gate, but also supply.
The gate being gated.
Apparently, according to the clip, she supplied
yes.
Campaign materials to the opponent of the party, the party where she belongs.
Yes.
Mm.
And they, It's confusion this time.
Right.
But it is what it is. What I know is that Koboko is a stronghold of NRM.
Mm.
The best way to campaign there is to find leverage and say, let me support this one so that people see me as one of them, and then we can win this.
Vivian, do you agree with him?
Yes, I actually do agree with him. But also, we know that Mr. Chagulani is trying to come off as a leader who is inclusive and accommodative, and like he calls it rubber dove style.
In a rubber dove style.
So we are yet to see what will come of that.
If you ask me, I don't think it's going to change much.
I sent you three clips.
I haven't seen them. I was on air.
Are you a senior?
This month, 20 years ago, when MTN first landed in, that is RDC, Asad Lutale.
Okay.
Yeah, he was saying, your government is the first to bring these people back from exile. Because all those people had been living in Sudan and Congo.
Mm.
And Ayume himself said during that function that Muzei in 96, I went to refugee camps to campaign. Now all the people are here.
Mm.
So Chagulanyi has discovered that when he was chasing the DPs, when he started NUP, he said, you are either with us or against us.
Yes.
Mm. That position is not easy.
It is.
So what is he doing now? He's becoming Museveni. Yeah? Let everybody come. And we have a broad base.
That is politics for him.
But you see, for him, he's doing it accidentally.
And then, he's
endorsed an FDC candidate.
Meanwhile, I hear the candidate in Agago has also, of NUP, has said he's not contesting, he has got a job somewhere.
Gentlemen, as we wind up, Ghana held its elections. Opposition has refuted the results. Then there's DRC political tensions.
I saw my senior Charles Onyango praising how Ghana, they have not killed anyone.
Is that true?
Finally, and a few people died Mr. John Mahama, Dramini Mahama, was contesting the outcome of the vote.
Yeah.
And a few protests, the European Union calls them isolated cases of violence.
what's wrong?
You see, in Uganda, I saw Crispin Kaheru calling for that there should be agreements between the presidential candidates.
Like in Ghana, up, by the way.
But you see, in Ghana, the political parties have armies, vigilante groups. Mm. They know them. And they have to sign agreements not to kill each other. The violence we are seeing here is between enforcers of SOPs and politicians. I have not seen party armies here tussling each other.
People, let's wind up this show. But Michael, my worry is on DRC, actually, that the coalition has been terminated. No, he wants to terminate the coalition and also dissolve parliament.
He hasn't yet.
That's his plan. And it's worrying, and I think it's going
when
to
you no longer need
potential.
It, you terminate it.
You see, I worry for Felix.
Tshisekedi?
Yes, I worry for him.
I thought Kulaiji.
In 2018, everyone didn't expect him to win that vote. In fact, most reports say he didn't win that vote.
It was because of Kabila.
He was forced to win.
Yeah, you were going to rule him. So, if you have a country where most members of parliament opposition, you would want to say opposition because they're actually out of a coalition. You don't have power.
No.
He wants to dissolve so he can
have another election. Oh my God.
Which is going to lose.
Like Obote dissolved the KY thing, the UPC KY.
Right. Gentlemen and ladies, thank you very much.
There's a resolution, Lynn.
What? Where?
When are we having more time for this program?
Yes.
don't dodge that one. Into.
Because if we pass a referendum, let's vote on it. How many? The eyes have it.
More time.
All right, that's all we had for you today. Definitely, we still had more for you, but time is up. We have to leave. Thank you very much for making time. And for you who has been watching, we really, really thank you very much. We'll definitely catch you again on Monday. We'll have more interesting things to talk about. Do take care of yourselves. Wear that mask. Please wear your mask. Wash your hands and carry a sanitizer if you must. Social distance. We're going into the weekend. Most of you just don't pay attention to any SOPs anymore. Your lives are at risk. We'll be back on Monday. But take great care of yourselves.